let's look into the assumptions, the hypotheses, and how to determine the critical value for a one-way ANOVA test. Here are the requirements for a one-way ANOVA, that is, an ANOVA conducted with a single factor, typically with three or more levels. The one-way ANOVA is a parametric procedure. We are using sampled data to estimate population parameters. Anytime we look at data drawn from a population, we are using parametric procedures. A one-way ANOVA can compare three or more groups. Whenever your independent variable has three or more levels, use ANOVA, not a t-test. Although ANOVA is designed for three or more groups, ANOVA can be conducted with only two groups, i.e., when you would typically use an independent samples t-test. In fact, you can convert between t and f, where t equals the square root of f. Now, just remember that a t-test can be either positive or negative, unlike the f-test that is always positive, because it's calculated with squared values. On the other hand, the sign of a t-value only tells us the direction of change, whether the first group or the second group has a higher mean. If you were to switch the groups, the sign would also switch. But if you do an ANOVA with just two groups and you want to calculate t, just be aware that the square root of f will always be positive. The independent variable groups must be independent. Independent means that the scores at one level do not influence the probability of scores in another level. So the groups are not influencing one another. The samples should not be related. If the samples are related, then you would use a repeated measures ANOVA. So here are the assumptions that must be satisfied for us to use the one-way ANOVA. The independent variable. The IV is categorical, or nominal, with three or more groups. The samples should be randomly selected. The samples can be randomly assigned, such as in an experimental design, but you could also use them naturally occurring in what is called a quasi-experimental design. The sample sizes for each group should be roughly equal. Unequal sample sizes increase the likelihood of type 1 error rates. And what do I mean by roughly equal? As a rule, the largest n divided by the smallest n of your groups should not exceed 1.5. The dependent variable must be quantitative at the scale level, so that's interval or ratio. Now, some people will tell you that if you use Likert survey scales, like 1 equals strongly disagree up to 5 equals strongly agree, that those data are ordinal and you have to use non-parametric statistics. In fact, John Dawes, 2008, demonstrated that when Likert survey scales have 5 or more item options, they function like scale data, and they can be used with parametric statistics like this one-way ANOVA. Check for outliers in your data cleaning using the Explore command. You should delete or Windsorize severe outliers. Scores in one group should not influence the probability of scores in another group. This is called independence. The participants in one group are in only one group. They are not in neither. They are not in both. And normality. The scores on the dependent variable within each group should be approximately normally distributed. The Shapiro-Wilk test and/or a QQ plot or a PP plot or a box plot are all used to test for normality. See my video about the central limit theorem for a fuller discussion about the implications of normality. If the dependent variables are not normally distributed, or if the sample sizes are not roughly equal, use the non-parametric Kruskal-Wallis one-way ANOVA test. However, the parametric one-way ANOVA that we are learning about now is robust as long as there is the minimum of 30 subjects in each sample. Robust means that the type 1 error rate doesn't increase if the assumptions are violated. Also, the groups should have homogeneity of variance, which you will test for using Levine's test for equality of variances, just as we did with the t-test. If the dependent variable groups fail this assumption, rerun the ANOVA and report Welch's ANOVA instead. Here are the hypotheses for a one-way ANOVA. Like a t-test, the null hypothesis for ANOVA is that all samples are drawn from a population whose means are equal. Therefore, all of the sample means are the same. So the null hypothesis might be written as H sub 0, mu 1, equals mu 2, equals mu 3. The alternative hypothesis is that the means of the three groups differ. And remember, we do not know which means differ. So the alternative hypothesis might be written as H sub 0, mu 1, does not equal mu 2, does not equal mu 3. Unless instructed otherwise, you should use the alpha of 0.05 for your level of significance for the omnibus ANOVA test. The critical value will be determined based upon your degrees of freedom and the alpha level, both of which are needed to use the ANOVA F table. I'll explain this in detail next. You can safely assume alpha equals 0.05, two-tailed test. On the other hand, you might protest that ANOVA is always a one-tailed test because the F distribution has only one tail. True. But the ANOVA is an omnibus test, and the post hoc tests are the ones that really matter. We could use the post hoc test to hypothesize directional group differences. But instead, we are just going to assume that all groups are equal and let the post hoc tests tell us which groups differ and in which direction. If we wanted to do directional post hoc tests, we would actually be better off to use a different technique called planned contrasts. More about that in another video. Finding the critical value for a one-way ANOVA requires knowing the degrees of freedom for the numerator and the denominator of the F ratio. These are called the degrees of freedom between, the degrees of freedom within, and the degrees of freedom total. The degrees of freedom between equals k minus 1, where k is the number of categories or levels. This is the degrees of freedom for the numerator. So in our example, where we have 20 people who are randomly assigned to four groups, k equals 4. So the degrees of freedom between would be 4 categories of diet, minus 1, or 3. Degrees of freedom within equals n minus k, where n is the total number of participants, and k is the total number of categories. This is the degrees of freedom for the denominator. The degrees of freedom within would be the total number of participants, 20, minus the total number of categories, 4, or 16. The degrees of freedom total equals n minus 1, as it always does, with n being the total number of participants in all groups. There are 20 participants, so the degrees of freedom total would be 19. Finding the critical value requires turning to the ANOVA F table. The degrees of freedom between are contained in the columns at the top of the table. The values for the degrees of freedom within are in the rows. The intersection of the column and the row is the critical value. So for 3 degrees of freedom between and 16 degrees of freedom within, the critical value is 3.24. And that is written CV 3, 16, both of those in parentheses, equals 3.24. Let's revisit that assumption of homogeneity of variance. The one-way ANOVA test assumes that there is equal variance of scores across groups, i.e. homogeneity of variance. Homogeneity means of the same nature, or the same kind of variability. Levine's test for equality of variances is a test of whether the variances of the samples or groups are approximately equal, or homogeneous. Now, this is the same test that we learned about with t-tests. We will ask for this when we run the ANOVA on the computer. However, as long as your sample sizes are greater than 30, and the groups have essentially the same number of people in each one, in other words, N1 equals N2 equals N3, then ANOVA is robust to violations of homogeneity of variance. Robust means that the type 1 error rate does not increase if the assumptions are violated. Another unique feature of the ANOVA test is something called the ANOVA summary table. Because there is so much information to know about in the ANOVA model and the sources of variance, it is much clearer to put all of this information into a table. The ANOVA summary table tells us 7 things. Number 1, the source of variability. Between, within, total, that goes in column 1. Second is the degrees of freedom, also between, within, and total. Degrees of freedom goes in column 2. Column 3 is the sum of squares associated with each, between, within, and total. Column 4 is variance, also called the mean square. So mean square, think of average of the squares. The mean square is the sum of squares divided by the degrees of freedom for each row. You only need the mean square for the first 2 rows, between and within. Fifth is the F ratio. The F ratio is the mean square between divided by the mean square within. The F ratio tells us that there is 17.619 times more variability between than there is within groups, p less than 0.001. As you can see, if you have degrees of freedom and the sum of squares, you could calculate the rest of the table from these values. Now, sixth is a column for probability values and another column for eta squared, the effect size. And just so that you know, those numbers in blue, 1 through 7, above each of the columns, were added for ease of identifying the columns. You should not include those numbers in your actual ANOVA summary table. When you use SPSS to conduct an ANOVA, the results will be presented to you in an ANOVA table like this. You would include the ANOVA table in your write-up for your research paper. I have also created this table titled Elements of the One-Way ANOVA Summary Table as a reference for learning about the ANOVA Summary Table. This table is a useful guide for what information goes in each part of the table. For example, under degrees of freedom on the row between, you see k minus 1. That is the formula for degrees of freedom between. This table is not meant to be explained in a video, but rather to serve as a reference as you are constructing your own ANOVA summary table.